Christ alone, my dwelling place. There is mercy, there is grace in Christ alone, Christ alone. I live to give you praise. Yes, I live to give you praise. In Christ alone. Christ alone is solid ground. In Christ alone I am free. In Christ alone eternity, yeah. In Christ I am free. In Christ alone, eternity. Yeah. In Christ alone. 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 Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone. Christ alone. I'm found in Christ alone. His solid crown in Christ alone. I am free in Christ alone. For eternity, yeah. In Christ alone, 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 in Christ alone. Oh, Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. But you're my everything. You're my everything. And in Christ alone I am found. In Christ alone. His solid crown. In Christ Christ alone, eternity, yeah. Christ alone, Christ alone, Christ alone. Oh, Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my transgression, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace so I could live. Oh, you were wounded for my transgression, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace so I could live. But you were wounded for my transgression, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace so I could live. But you were wounded for my transgression, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace so I could live. So I can live in you. So I can live in you. So I can live with you. So I can live with you. Oh Lord, I live in you. Oh Lord, I live in you. And Lord, I live by you. Oh Lord, I live by you. Lord, I live. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone my everything. Ooh, yeah. Christ alone my all and all. Christ alone my everything. Christ alone my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. Christ alone, my all and all. Christ alone, my everything. And you were wounded for my transgression. Bruised for my sin, punished for my peace, so I could live. But you were wounded for my transgressions, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace, so I. But you were wounded for my transgression, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace, so I could live. So I could live in you.
Thank you.
am living and moving and dwelling in you. Yes, I am living and moving and dwelling in you. Yes, I am living and moving and dwelling in you.
Shall continually be In my mouth will I magnify the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord. Let everyone who loves his salvation say continually, the Lord be magnified. Lord be magnified. Be highly exalted now in me. Far above all things, every name that is named. Far above all things, Jesus be exalted in my life.
Yeah.
Be exalted in me. Be magnified in me. Be glorified in us, Jesus. In the midst of your church, we sing praises. In the midst of the congregation. In the midst of the church, we sing praises. In the midst of the congregation, there's a great assembly. Great cloud of witnesses, there's a great assembly. Oh, a great cloud of witnesses. In the midst of the church, we sing praises. In the midst of the congregation. In the midst of the church, we sing praises. In the midst of the congregation. Jesus, Jesus.
Under your wings, there is peace, oh God. Under your wings, there is safety. Under your wings, there abiding place under your wings, oh God, there is peace under your wings, there is joy under your wings, under thank you. lift our song, to lift our song. O King of glory, we've come tonight to lift our song. Under your wings, your protection, we lift our song. The song of the redeemed, the angels fall silent. The song of the redeemed, that is our song. To come to proclaim your goodness, that's our song. To declare your glory, that is our song. To declare your power, your grace, your mercy, that is our song. The song of the redeemed. Come on, lift your voices, lift your hands. The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
I am the redeemed. We are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I am redeemed. Oh, I am redeemed. Redeemed by the blood of Jesus. I am redeemed. We are redeemed. Redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Redeemed, 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 redeemed. Let all of the redeemed of the Lord say so. I am redeemed, I am redeemed, redeemed by the precious blood of Christ. I am redeemed, I am redeemed, redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Let all of the redeemed say so. Blood of Jesus, as a lamb that was slain from the very overthrow. Jesus Christ, my King, my Redeemer, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Redeemed, redeemed, I am.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord God.
Hallelujah.
You are faithful.
Holy are you, Lord. Holy are you, Lord. Holy are you, Lord. Holy are you, Lord. Faithful. Faithful and true. Faithful, faithful. Faithful and true. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Kola ba shendede. Ola ba shetete. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like your song again.
Sing like never before. above every name.
Name Jesus.
Jesus.
Great I am, Almighty God. Jesus. Jesus. Jesus.
Oh, we love that name.
Authority.
Oh, a name of authority. Jesus.
Our glory.
Oh, hallelujah.
All glory and honor belongs to you, Lord. All glory and honor belongs to you, Lord. All glory and honor belongs to you, Lord. All glory and honor belongs to you. All glory and honor belongs to you, Lord. All glory and honor belongs to you.
All honor, all glory, majesty, omnipotent one, Jesus, Jesus, all authority, all the glory,
all glory and honor
belongs to you.
All glory and honor
all belongs to you.
You alone and by yourself, with your power, God, you came, redeemed every soul who asked. You alone and by yourself, oh God, redeemed my soul from sin, redeemed our lives from death. You alone and by yourself opened up the doors of heaven and gave us all access to this realm that only you belong to.
As we lift up the name of Jesus, the Holy Spirit fills the place. He comes to be our witness of who Jesus is, to reveal Jesus. The Holy Spirit is our witness. Welcome you, Lord God, Holy Spirit, into this place, to this place, Holy Spirit, God in the earth, God in.
Listen, it's so important for you to understand that the living God came and opened up the door into the realms of His glory, into the realms of His holy presence, into the realms of everything that He is. And He invites us to come on in. He invites us to come into life, because without Him, there is no life. You're dead while you live. And then He looks at us and He says to us, I'm going to give you the best thing I have. I'm going to give you the best gifts. I'm going to give you that which is the greatest treasure to me. I'm going to give you something that goes far beyond all riches and far beyond all that you can ask, far beyond anything that I know of. This is what the Lord is saying. I give you the Holy Spirit. I give you the Holy Ghost. So many people are trapped in a world around them they cannot see. They're so blinded by the things of humanity, so lost and trapped in a world of darkness. They can't see this beauty, this splendor, this life that belongs to eternity, this realm that God Himself purchased for you and me, not because of anything that we're worthy of or deserving of. When we were without God, when we were without hope, He commended his love towards us. Not by any works of righteousness which we have done. People think that somehow that they're going to grow in God. They're going to mature in the things of the Spirit. Listen, people think that they're going to receive from heaven somehow different than the way they began. See, Paul said, have you begun in the Holy Ghost to now be made perfect by your own human ability? Jesus didn't come to you and extend his love to you because you deserved it or because you earned it. Look, the influences of Hinduism have got to go someday. The influences of Buddhism have got to go someday.
Right.
The influences of all the religious works that somehow is going to attain some merit with God has somehow got to come to an end in your mind. And you're going to have to start seeing that God has commended all this glory of his divine power and a presence to anyone who will believe. Not because we're deserving. Not because we've earned it. Not because somehow we by our own self and ability pleased him. But if you can begin now to look at the one who did please him. If you can begin to look at the one who never sinned, who never transgressed, who in every way fulfilled all God's will, who left all of his riches and became poor for our sake, that through his poverty we might be made rich. If you could just begin, those of you who know him, and then those of you who may be standing here tonight or listening on the web or by YouTube, you've not been introduced to him. Maybe God was pulling on your heart, but religion trapped you. Christian religion. There's a religion called Christian religion, just like there's other kinds of religions. The Lord Jesus didn't die at Calvary's cross, go down into hell. First of all, he didn't leave heaven and become incarnated and take upon the form of sinful flesh, live out the life that he lived out, die at Calvary, go down into hell for you and me, raise up from the dead so that you and I could come into some kind of human religion, some form and ritual of men. He opened up a door so that you and I can be translated,
come on.
Having been delivered from the power and the stronghold of Satan. Translated. See, back in the days of Daniel was a man who pleased God and walked with God in a glorious way. But when he began to pray, Satan was able to launch an attack and stop him. That don't even exist now. Lest you let it exist. Jesus destroyed that power. Jesus destroyed that authority. He stripped him. In other words, he paralyzed him from the eyebrows down. He stripped all principalities and powers. God gave him a name that is above every name. The name of Jesus has been exalted far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion. The Lord Jesus called you and I up. Listen, he's called you and I up. We can rejoice in that, and we should. But then to begin to enter into the benefits of it, the way that he's called us up to be seated together with him. God wants there to be an increase of himself in your life. See, the scripture says increase with the increase of God, or grow with the growth of God in your life. People are stuck in a human realm and being deceived by lying powers of darkness, and everybody's confirming that is normal. I tell you, that's not normal. It's demonic. What you see in the culture of society around you, the things that you're, the people that were peers to you and were teachers and mentors to you, they haven't shown you the way of life. All they did was espouse those things within the culture of men designed by devils. The light came and shined into the world. We behold that light, and that light is the life of men. And that light is shining right now. And tonight, I want you to step in, says the Lord, into a realm of divine power and glory that you could never earn nor deserve. I want you to understand the mystery of the fellowship. I want you to recognize the riches that I put on the inside of you. I want you to know about the power that is at work within you. I want you to see that the excellency of the glory and the powers of me, says God. I'm telling you right now, if you don't believe that heaven's full of excitement and emotions, just read Isaiah chapter 6. And look at the seraphim spin as they worship. One time I was some preachers came to me and they said, well, you know, we don't think it's right that a pastor should dance as wildly as you do. And so I, being respectful, I said, okay, what do you reckon I ought to do? They said, well, we're not saying God said, but, you know, you should at least reconsider when you start spinning around like that and doing all those things you do. And so that night, I mean, I said, I'm not going to be arrogant. I'll humble myself. I'm going to tell you right now, you want to step into a greater realm of the anointing, you're going to have to walk in a greater realm of humility. You want to hook up with Jesus in a greater way, then you walk in a greater realm of lowliness and meekness. And I know the way. And that is to just quit making you irrelevant. You know, the Lord says, get out of the way, get out of the way, get out of the way. You know how he said it? You are dead. That's it. Get out of the way. Your life is hid. That's get out of the way. And Christ who is your life. Colossians chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. I mean, come on, is that get out of the way, get out of the way, get out of the way. Come on, people. I'm telling you right now, Jesus purchased something for us that has a greater impact and effect on our life right now than what Adam did. Adam's transgression cannot even hold a candle to the obedience of Christ Jesus. And now, as sin came upon all men because of that disobedience, those who would believe tonight, you can step into the realm of divine glory. People all up and messed up with finances, material things. God's put a treasure on the inside of you and has developed a treasure for you to begin to pull out of his abundance. Now unto him is able to do superabundantly above all that you can think or ask according to the power. That's at work. That's at work. Right here on the inside of you and me. There's a power. There's a treasure that we have in these earthen vessels. That the excellency of the glory and the power may be of God. And the whole problem is that we entangle what Jesus did with us. And it can't be. He's invited us to come dwell in him. He says, come live with me. And if you'll just respond to the invitation, everything about your life will begin to change. Because through him, all heaven's glory is released. Through him, the Holy Ghost is poured out without measure. Through him, and by him, we have access into the holies of holies. And by his blood, we stand there with no sense or conscience of sin. With all boldness, we stand before God, and we gaze upon him, that which even the seraphim veil their face, that they not may not look upon that glory. Now, the Lord doesn't say, I'm going to hide you in the cleft of the rock. He says, stare at me. He with an unveiled face. Now we take the veil off with an unveiled face. Come behold me.
Come on.
All through Jesus Christ, all by the working power of the Holy Ghost. Tonight, if you've never been baptized in the Holy Ghost, Christ Jesus started his church. Acts chapter 2 and verse 4. The last two things that Jesus said is this. He said, remember what John said. I baptize you with water, but you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost.
Come on.
Not many days from now. He said, after that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, shall receive power, that then you can be witnesses. You can be those who give true witness and testify to me. Listen to me here tonight, because I know there's some of you who've never stepped into this because people have held you back. Religion has held you back. Jesus had an earthly ministry, and that earthly ministry goes on forever. But let me tell you something. He's got a heavenly ministry right now, too.
Hallelujah.
His earthly ministry is where he went to the cross and he bore our sins away in his own body. His earthly ministry is when he went down into hell for 3 days. His earthly ministry is when he came up from the grave with power over death and hell. But then his heavenly ministry began. John identified him as the one who had baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. Jesus never baptized anybody in the Holy Ghost and fire, but he talked about it. He said, if anybody's really thirsty, if anybody wants to move past the religious expressions, come to me and I will give you to drink. And out of your belly shall flow these rivers of living water, that which comes from the throne of God, the very character and expression of God Almighty, to know what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and be filled with all the fullness of God. This spake he of the Holy Ghost. I can't help it that some of you have been told that somehow the Holy Ghost is a spook. That somehow the Holy Ghost is someone to be ashamed of. That his expressions are something that does not belong in the midst of the church. But I'm telling you right now, heaven's full of a bigger expression of life and celebration and emotion. We do not hold to what Aristotle taught, or Socrates taught, or Plato taught, or Krishna taught, or Buddha taught. We hold to that which God has revealed and taught to us by the Holy Ghost. And he talks to us about joy unspeakable. Look at here. Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. God said, I'll dance over you.
Yeah. What he said?
I'll dance over you. That night, God gave me a dream. I'm going to quickly tell you this. That night, the Lord gave me a dream. I said, Lord, what do you want me to do? I don't want to be embarrassing you. I don't really care if I embarrass anyone else. I've never really been confined to what other people think about me. Praise God. I mean, just I was born that way. I've never been concerned. But I am concerned about what Father says, how it impacts him. That night I had a dream. I had a vision. And I saw the seraphim. Yeah. And I saw them worship the Lord as they flew. Scripture says, with two wings, they covered their face. And with two wings, they covered their feet. And with two wings, they did fly. And I saw them twirling and spinning and going from one end to the next end of that. As it were a room. Because I know what they're doing can't even be contained within space. Wow. And the beauty and the splendor of it. As they cried out, holy! with shouts, with shrills of divine glory. I watched them dance. I watched them with great emotion and great excitement worship the living God as they cried, holy, holy. And it goes on bigger than that, and it's brighter than that, and it's more glorious. You're going to have to go there yourself. Listen to me tonight. Everybody in this place, within 100 years, you're going to have one of the greatest breakthroughs you could ever imagine. You're going to step out of this world into the next. Some of you, you may not. I mean, there are people I thought would live a long time. They're already dead. Everybody believes that they know at what moment in time that they depart from this world and step over to the next. I want you to step over into heaven tonight. I want you to recognize you can be translated. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And that I want you to understand, I've been translated. Somebody said, what are you talking about? Colossians chapter 1:13. I was delivered from the power of darkness, and I was translated over to the kingdom of the dear Son. Hallelujah. Father has this for you tonight. Sickness has no hold on me. I conquered it at Calvary. I'm seated in heavenly places. Satan, he has no hold on me. Crushed his head at Calvary. I'm seated in heavenly places.
Hallelujah.
Living Word transforming me. Sons of God to maturity.
Yeah, come on.
I'm seated in heavenly places. We invite you to just come on in. Stand over here on the other side with us. Quit allowing the enemy to strip from you your identity, to accuse you, to browbeat you, to condemn you, to shame you because you're an idiot. Or because you failed or slipped up or stupid or immature or childish or just don't get it yet. God's grace is so big in this place. God's grace. So many people do not grow with the growth of God because they begin in the Holy Ghost. They have a supernatural visitation from heaven. that they are born again. Listen, to tonight we're going to give you an opportunity not to join up with religion, but to have the Spirit of the Lord come upon you and change you into a new creation. If I tell you right now, if there's anything people need to hear, is to receive the life of Christ. And the only way that you can receive the life of Christ is that you have a Holy Ghost visitation, that you allow the power of God to come upon you and change you into a new man. Into one that is created in His righteousness and true holiness, and He's made it. Look, you don't have to earn it. If you stand there and say there's something terribly wrong with me and I can't have it and whatever, you come up, we'll pray for you, and we'll run that devil off of you. We'll cast that evil spirit off of you so that you can freely receive what God has freely given. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you, tonight we're not going to leave you alone until you are born of the Spirit and filled with the Holy Ghost. We're here for you tonight. We're here to pray you through. So that you can learn how to dance. Because there's no sedate in heaven. Sedate is not a fruit of the Spirit. It's a demonic stronghold of the religious powers of men and of devils. It's the influence of religions that were created out of hell. God gives us holy emotions. Hallelujah. He gives us to dance. He gives us to shout. He gives us to praise. Look, I want to talk to you about weapons of the warfare, but the biggest weapon of the warfare in the Old Testament was praise, the shout. The walls of Jericho came down by the shout. God's people constantly destroyed the powers of the enemy by the shout, by the praise.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! When Israel was having a move of God and began to praise Him, they would rend the earth with the sound of their voice. You could hear them in the next door neighbor nation. Not just next down the street, the next nation.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
It's time you learn how to dance. It's time you learn how to joy. It's time you learn how to rejoice. It's time you learn how to give thanks in all things. It's time you learn how to rejoice forevermore. Hallelujah. It's time you learn how to pray without ceasing and praise without ceasing. And you will, if you'll take God up on His invitation. To come on in and behold Him. He says peace. He said peace to those who are near. That would be the Jewish people, the people of the descendants of Abraham, those who were under the covenant of the law of Moses. Peace to those who are near. And peace to those far away. That would be the Scythian. The Scythian, the most immoral, most wicked people on the face of the earth during that time. He says, come on in. A time not too... In the too distant past, He said, no, you can't come near Me, draw not nigh.
Right.
But when Jesus did something, He changed it all.
Come on, right.
He changed everything about the way it all works, about our rights and privileges no longer to be held under the pseudo-sovereignty of a satanic realm and a power of death. God said, I will not regard iniquity in Israel, neither will I behold their transgression. When somebody was trying to curse Him. Come on, man. Come on in. We got a better covenant. Come on, man. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. If you begin to believe this, you'll be so ecstatic all the time. You'll be so happy all the time. You say, woo, Jesus is good. Woo-hoo. God's so good to me. My Redeemer lives. And He stands up. He not only stands upon the earth in the last day, He stands inside of me.
Come on, come on, come on, come on.
I just had to share that with you.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Hallelujah.
Say, I know my Redeemer lives.
I know my Redeemer lives.
And He lives right now in me.
He lives right now in me.
The new covenant is this. He has written His ways, His law, His word upon our heart and upon our mind, our thinking realm.
Yep. Right.
They're already hooked up. We're out of the abundance of the heart. The mind works. A man thinks. Hallelujah. He said, I will be their God. He says to me, he said, I will be your God, Mark. Well, it was a glorious day when I started reading the Bible as a love letter from heaven directly to me. I'll be your God, Mark, and you will be my people. I will bring you into a oneness with me. I'll make you a part of my family, and all that I have, it's yours. As any dad gives to his son, all that I have, I'll make you an heir with me. I'll make you a co-inheritor with the one who championed your salvation and purchased it all. Just finished it all and settled it all and sealed forever your place with me. Having obtained eternal salvation. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Woo. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Somebody said, well, do you believe in eternal security? When you fall in love with Jesus, I'm telling you right now, you eternally secure. When it gets to be a love relationship like this. Hallelujah. Tonight, I want you to just appreciate and value the reality that Father said, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your son and I want to your children, I want you to imagine the best thing you could ever bless your kids with. Then Father says, I got something for you that you can't even imagine. I will give the Holy Ghost. I'll give the Holy Spirit. I'll give the best thing that I have and the best thing that I know of to anyone who asks. Within that and within the framework of that is all the realms of the kingdom. Because you remember, he said, as he said in Luke, I'll give you the Holy Ghost. He said in Matthew, I'll give you the kingdom.
Yeah.
And when the Holy Ghost steps in, heaven steps in. When the Holy Ghost steps in, kingdom steps in. Ha! When the Holy Ghost steps in, Jesus steps in. Hallelujah. When the Holy Ghost steps in, Father comes and dwells with you. People, it's time we quit making Father an unwelcome guest because we live in a lie and shame that the enemy of our soul will try to put upon us, and start just walking around just thanking God for his goodness, even when they're all you could see maybe is your problems and your failures and your badness and your weakness. You didn't get into this because you were so good. You got into this because God is so good. You didn't get into this because you loved him so much. You got into this because he loves us so much. And Father's just looking for some people. Father's looking for some people who are willing to hear his word and believe and begin to step out with him and do what it is he says to do. And at that very moment, he'll pour out upon you the ability to see, the ability to know. He'll give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. Your eyes will be open. You'll recognize that not only is more with us than are with them, but God is in us.
Come on.
And we complete in him.
That's right. We're complete in him.
Complete. Say, I'm complete tonight.
I'm complete.
And I don't want to be anything else.
I'm completed in him.
Not everyone will believe. Not everyone will respond to this great love. And unfortunately, as a result, many people will spend an eternity in a place that was created for the devil and his angels because they defiantly refuse to hear the love of God. Everybody knows on the inside, deep in their soul, that those things that are written in this word, and those things that we declare concerning God and concerning his only begotten son, that they are absolutely true. The witness of the Spirit is given and poured out upon all flesh. He's hovering and brooding over all humanity right now. Christ Jesus has extended his love. He said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men. He's drawing every single one. The grace of God has appeared to every man, not leaving anyone out.
That's right.
Teaching us, showing us, wanting
that's
to lead us.
Right.
Not everyone will come. Men have sinned in darkness and under the shadow of death, but now light sprung up.
Come on, that's right.
It was a terrible fate. Men sitting in darkness and under the shadow of death, but now the light's come. Here's the great sad thing. Men love darkness rather than life, rather than light, because their deeds are evil. Tonight, Father invites you to come and behold how good he is, how wonderful he is, how good the life is that he created you to have. God the Holy Spirit is here to produce in your life, if you will let him, what God the Father created you to be. Do not hesitate to respond to his word, to be caught up in this glorious liberty of the sons of God, to become so excited about who he is. And what's happened? We become so excited about who he is, we forget all about who we are.
Yeah.
And then one day, all of a sudden, we maybe think something, think and say, well, what about me? And then we realize, I'm dead. Somebody said that Christ Jesus provided for us a vicarious offering, a substitutionary offering at Calvary. I don't see that. I was crucified.
Come on.
Somebody said, you were born 2,000 years later. It was a miracle. It's something that happens that makes time irrelevant. It's eternal, and it's in an eternal realm.
Right.
And so it's just as real right now as it was the very moment that it happened. The resurrection is just as real right now the moment it happened. Listen, the ascension just as real as the moment it happened. The outpouring of Pentecost just as real right now the moment it happened. And sometimes we just think that somehow it's locked away in another generation at another time. No, this is a day. This is the day. It's a time. It's a moment. You can live the rest of it. Listen, we're going to give you an invitation many times tonight. We're going to tell you. I just feel my heart's just pounding with this. We're going to continue tonight to give you an invitation to step right now into heaven. To leave all of the shame, to leave the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life, the twisted, wicked way of sin and iniquity behind, no longer to live in fellowship and communion with demon spirits, to step over into the realms of the Holy Spirit and live out your life as in a companionship with God, the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You listen to me. The day that you were born in sin. And from that day, you were shaped every day in iniquity to be just like the devil, to think like the devil, to want those things that the demonic realm wants, to live in a realm of darkness and be content. But tonight, God gives you the opportunity to be born in righteousness.
Come on.
To now be shaped every day of your life by the purity of the Holy Spirit. Think about it. Every day shaped in purity. To now learn to hate evil and love righteousness. To learn to know the ways of God. To interact with them. To fellowship with them. And we believe in God that tonight you are going to have a suddenly. You're going to have a suddenly. You're going to have a visitation. And I want to turn this over here to Joe here in just a minute. Servant of the Lord Joe and Becky. And listen, before you go tonight, I don't know when we're going to do it, but we're going to receive an offering. Before you go tonight, and then we have the offering baskets, always we have them up here. I was thinking of making them bigger. I thought they would be much better if they were like 6 foot tall and about 4 foot wide. Just has some big, giant offering baskets up here. Give people plenty of room to give.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because it's big to God. It's a big deal to God. Somebody said, well, why do we have to come up in front of everybody? Because this is the way the Lord did it. He stood over by the offering baskets. And he watched what everybody put in. Hallelujah. Because it's important to Father. He did what Father does. Every time the offering comes, Father's right over there and he's looking. And he's going, well, that's pretty good. Or look at that. Turns to angels, turns to Jesus. Look at that offering. Because it's important to him. Because your trust, your value, so much of our life is wrapped up in that. Because that's how we eat. That's how we sleep. That's how we live. And Father wants us to find that there's so much more life in
you.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Woo!
Hallelujah. Woo. Oh, my gosh. I'm just in heaven right now, okay? Honestly. Hallelujah. The Lord is so good. I tell you, before you sit down, go ahead and prepare your offering. And we'll do that now because if we don't do that now, and this is a part of worship. Amen. This is a part of worship. Oh, Pastor Mark. Oh, the word just flows out of him. The word, revelation flows out of him. You know, I've had those kinds of dreams. I was leading worship one Sunday in a church, and I was in the middle of a song, and I had this just a
shutter open for a moment, and I saw the Lord stand to receive my praise. I saw Jesus stand to receive my praise. And I heard him say, hold on, Father, I know that sound. I know that. Oh, yeah, that's old Joe down there, Father. I know. Hold on just a minute. And he stopped everything he was doing to receive my praise. And when that happened, it literally changed the way that I approached the Lord. That he would stop what he was doing, and he knew my voice. Just like your thumbprint, there's not two of them alike on the planet. Your voice patterns, there's not two of them alike on the planet. He knows your voice. He knows the sound of your voice. As you sow tonight, you're not just sowing to Pastor Becky and myself, but you're sowing into Worship Works Ministries International. We have a music college that's online, and we have students from Europe, South Africa, from Brazil, from Asia, from here in the United States of America, from right here in San Diego, California. We have students from right here in Abiding Place. We have an instructor from the church here. Brother Josh is one of our instructors. So as you sow seed tonight, you're not just sowing into Becky and myself. You're sowing into nations. You're sowing into young men and women. You're sowing into instructors that carry the sound of heaven. And so we want to thank you ahead of time for your generosity. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your faithfulness, oh God. Lord, we thank you that every need for WMI is met. Lord, we will never lack. Lord, the dreams. Lord, the things that we have seen. Lord, we thank you that in the natural, they may not be in our hand as of yet. But Lord, as we continue to sow seed, Lord, we have it. It's ours. The properties, the instructors, the students that are believing God right now to come to the school, everything they need is in their hand in the form of seed. Father, we love you. We magnify you. We glorify you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. For us to run our school for one semester, it's only about $35,000. The last year I ran our school back in Austin, and we had the campus and everything, it cost me $1.1 million to run that school for 1 year. I think we've done a good job of taking care of God's money. And so we can do a whole year of school for about $70,000. So just continue to pray, agree with us, that God will put everything we need in our hands. We will never lack. Father, we thank you for the students. They're on their way. For new instructors, as the school grows, they're on the way. Father, we thank you. We see the vision complete and fulfilled. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. If you know it, sing it with me. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. See, once you've tasted, you can't go back. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of love, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. It's exactly what you're talking about. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Come on, just for a little while longer, lift your hands, sing in the Holy Ghost, sing a new song. Suddenlies are so important to me It's because I've lived a life of suddenlies. I've lived a life of suddenlies. When the Lord began to lay these things on our heart, basically what he did was he began to remind me of how I got to where I am today. Our family started out singing when I was 16 years of age. We were good old Southern Baptist kids. And for whatever reason, there's no one in our family who can play. And so we would get in the car, and out in West Texas where my dad was pastoring, back then was only three channels of TV, and when it got to be 10, 11 o'clock at night, there was nothing on. So what my dad would do was he would get in his car after church on Sunday night. You can stay with me. And we would begin to ride in the car just for my dad so that my mom and dad could decompress from all day at church. Whether it was a good day or a bad day, they would get in the car and they would begin to drive. And just they'd ride out there and they could see all the oil derricks that were, I mean, for miles and miles, it's flat. You can see just the lights that look like Christmas trees stuck out in the middle of nowhere. And back when I was a little boy like that, this was, you know, 50-something years ago, we would sit in the car and we'd ride and we'd see jackrabbits along the side and coyotes run along. And it was soothing for my dad. My dad and mom would start to sing in the car. And then as each one of us kids began to grow older and begin to learn the songs, then my mom would teach us parts. And so then whenever one day someone heard us sing, the electrical co-op out there, they asked us to come and do an event for them. We only knew a couple of songs, and I can't even remember what they were, but they were kind of God and country kind of songs. And then that began to change to where the Civitan and the Rotary Club would ask us, and the Lions Club would ask us to come and do their luncheons, and we would do God and country songs for them. And then we moved to East Texas. And just before we went, we did a revival meeting. And at that revival meeting, or just before we went to that revival, my dad and mom said, you know what, let's learn a couple of two or three or four songs so that when we go to the revival and dad preaches, well, we can at least do the special music. And so the first song we learned as a family was, Let Me Touch Him, Let Me Touch Jesus, Let Me Touch Him As He Passes By. Anyway, the second one was Until Then, My heart will go on singing. Until then, with joy I'll carry on until the day mine eyes behold that city. Until the day God calls me home. And then we learned the other one that brother, let me touch him, and then he touched me. He touched me, oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. And then we learned one more. I can't remember what it was. But anyway, then on Friday night, we did a concert of all four songs. Or all five songs, whatever it was. But no one played, so we had to sing them a cappella. And so then as we moved to East Texas, then we found this Pentecostal, this little girl, because we didn't have anyone in our family. No one played an instrument. And she was this Holy Ghost Pentecostal girl, began to play, and she helped us do some of the concerts. And then one time they invited us to do the rodeo in this little town where we lived, and we did Put Your Hand in the Hand of the Man from Galilee, and the green grass of home, and stuff like that. But it opened doors, and pastors heard us singing at that rodeo and began to ask us to come to their church and for my dad to do revival meetings. And so it began to grow out of that. But as our family began to do revival meetings, what you don't realize and understand is growing up, I had asthma. I was an asthmatic. And so I took an enormous amount of medication just to breathe. And they would either put me under an oxygen tent or they'd fill me full of drugs so that I could breathe. And so we're down in A-Leaf, Texas, outside of Houston. And my dad and mom, we were all doing a revival, and a pastor, for whatever reason, I couldn't sing. I had this asthma attack, and I couldn't get relief, so I couldn't sing. One of the very few times in my life I couldn't sing. And dad and the pastor of this Baptist church came home at the end of the meeting, and they walked in there in my room. I stayed in somebody else's home. And they said, son, Dad said, son, this pastor wants to pray for you. And I said, fine. And he said, he wants to anoint you with oil and lay hands on you and pray for you. I said, great. He prayed for me, anointed me with oil. They walked out of the room. I really didn't feel anything. But when I woke up the next morning, I was totally whole. And I never had an asthma attack after that. Not a one. When I was 12, I was the only one from our church that went to youth camp. But it was at that youth camp that I surrendered my life, not to be saved, but to serve the Lord all my life. I didn't know what that meant at the time. I'll be a missionary. I'll be a song leader. I'll be whatever you want me to do. And in my lifetime, God has allowed me to do all of those wonderful things. As we're traveling and singing, well, I got to get this right. I'm 21 years of age, and I'm down in Miami, Florida. And our family is traveling and singing for some of the largest conventions of the Baptist church. And I'm laying, and Becky has been with us now for 3 years. She came with us when she was 16 years of age. Because no one in our family played. And she had this deep crush that I would like her. But I was too busy and pretty blind at the time because I was in large churches with lots of girls. And you know how it is. You want to be cool. You don't want to be tied down. You know, all that kind of thing. But now I'm 21 years of age, and I'm laying in this hotel room, and I'm praying, Lord, if this is what you want me to do the rest of my life, where is that young woman? You're going to have to show me this lady that I'm going to spend my lifetime with. That's going to want to love revival and want to travel the world and all those wonderful things. But, you know, sometimes we're a little slow. Guys are a little slow, okay? Girls get it sometimes a whole lot quicker than guys get it. And so, I mean, it's like I'm laying there praying this big prayer. Becky's been with us for 3 years.
I'm the only one
that's not family traveling with us. And I hear the Lord say, she's been with you 3 years. Now, I'm not filled with the Holy Ghost yet. This is just God speaking. And the moment I heard the Lord say, she's been with you 3 years, the moment I heard that, I said, Becky? Like this big, heavy rivy, you know, Becky? And the moment I spoke her name, the peace of God fell all over me. And I knew instantly that she was the one. Little did I know that she had already called her mom and told her mom that was her last trip. She was headed home once we got back to Texas. I immediately got up. We were staying in three rooms. The boys had a room, the girls had a room, and mom and dad had their room. I went to the elevator, went immediately down to where the girls' room was, knocked on the door. And the moment I knocked on the door, one of my sisters came to the door. And, what do you need? She's in this long, brown, ugly robe. My grandmother made all the girls the same robe every year for Christmas. And I said, I need to talk to Becky right now. And my wife-to-be comes walking around from the bathroom with orange cans in her hair, in a brown robe and brushing her teeth. And she said, what do you want? And I'm shaking like a leaf with my hands on the door, and I said, we are supposed to get married. And her eyes got real big. She swallowed her toothpaste, took her toothbrush out of her mouth, and she said, well, don't you think we ought to date first? And I said, we can if you want to. And for the first time, we held hands. And then it was just a couple of years after that we had been married, and I was 31. This is now 1985. We're down in, I'm going to say this right, we're in Winter Park, Florida, at Calvary Assembly. And we're doing an event for about 800 single adults. And we finished that meeting. And the pastor, the singles pastor, walks up to my wife and I and our team, and he says, he looks me straight in the eye and he goes, I've got a word for you and your family. Well, I figured he's upset. He didn't like what I wore. It was too loud. you know, something, you know, whatever it was, he didn't like it. So I'm fixing to get chewed out. That's what I thought. I got a word for you. When my daddy said, I got a word for you, that meant you're in trouble. I didn't know what a word was. I'd never had a word. I said, okay. So we went, sat down, had some snacks back there, and he began to say this. He said, you and your dad are at outs with each other. Now, we've been traveling, received all the awards. I mean, at this point in time, things are flying pretty high. But we're empty. We're empty. I mean, in the music field at that time, it was Sandy Patty, it was our family, Carmen, and a few others in that realm that were being asked to do the majority of the music. The Archers and a bunch of those guys, you know, that you would know out here in California. And he looked at me and he said, you and your father at outs with each other. No, first thing he said was this. I got to tell you this first. He said, your ministry as you know it, it's dead. It stinks. It needs to be buried. And then he said, you and your father are at house with each other. And he said, that needs to be fixed. And then he looked at me and my wife and he said, she doesn't even want to be here. And then he looked at my sister and he said this and that. He read our mail and I'm like going, oh my God. So that meeting went till about 3 o'clock in the morning. The reason I'm telling you this is because of what your pastor said a while ago about being filled with the Holy Ghost, having an encounter with the Holy Spirit, and for your life forever to be changed. Now, we've been artists to this point. I mean, getting paid lots of money to do what we do. And so I'm sitting there, and he tells me these things. The meeting ends around 3 o'clock in the morning, and we head off to bed. I can't sleep. So I'm laying in my bed and I'm thinking in my mind, she don't want to be here, which I knew that. She was tired of traveling and all the things. It was not pretty. There were a lot of things happening. Not immoral things, but just that dissension, that strife that can happen as you do what you do, working with family and ministry and business and all of those things. Dad wanted us to stay closer to the church. We were playing all the amusement parks and all the universities and colleges, and we were flying high, man. We felt like the church was holding us back. My dad was grieved in his spirit because he loved the church, and he knew God loved the church. And so I go to bed. At about 7 o'clock in the morning, I couldn't stand any longer. I said, I got to call Dad. The Lord had been dealing with me. It didn't hurt that I'd been reading The Tale of Three Kings. Didn't hurt. Great book. And so anyway, I called Dad on the phone. I said, Dad, and I didn't have a cell phone. I had to go in the pastor's house, sit in his house where everybody could hear you. Hey, Dad, I got to tell you what's going on out here in Florida. This is what my dad said. He said, before you go into what you're, and normally I'd have said, no, I called you. Let me go first. We'd have gotten a fight over who's going to go first. But for whatever, I said, what's happening, Dad? What's going on? He said, funny thing, son. He said, last night, about 3 o'clock in the morning, he said, the Lord awakened your mother and myself. I said, really? He said, yeah. He said, I didn't know if you'd had a wreck. I didn't know if something had happened. But he said, I had this tenacious desire to pray. I had to pray. So I shook your mom and I said, Nancy, wake up. We got to pray. We got to pray. Now, we're 1,100 miles apart. And so my dad, he said, we sat up in the bed. We grabbed each other's hands, and we started praying the way we know to pray. Now, Father, we're going to ask you in Jesus' name, wherever the kids are, to protect them. And he said, son, I did not get through 30 seconds of my prayer. And he said, son, we stepped over into another realm. And he said, into a language I've never experienced in my life. And he said, heaven filled our house. And he said, son, things are different in our house. When you get home, things will be different when you get home. I didn't have to say a word. He said, whatever God's doing, you be open to it. So I get off the phone and I turn to the guys and I tell them what I just heard from my father. And the pastor said, well, do y'all have to go anywhere? I said, no, we're great. I said, we were just going to go over here to Disney and hang out for a day. He said, why don't you just stay here? And he said, let us love on you. I said, sure. October 30th, 1985, suddenly, I went into this church, large church, Clattenburg was the pastor at the time. And they had a ministry there called Deliverance. And basically their snowbirds that would come from the north would come, and they were a part of their prayer team. And he took me to meet a lady by the name of Dottie. She was around 67, 68 years of age. I've never met her since. I was in her presence for about 2 hours. But she walked up and she said, "Hi, my name's Dottie." I said, "Hi, I'm Joe, and this is my wife, Becky." She said, "I'm so honored to meet you." She said, "How can I help you?" I said, "I don't know. I'm here with the pastor." He said, "We're going to be here, and we're just going to spend some time in prayer." She said, "Wonderful." What I didn't know was is they were going to lead me through what's called deliverance. And they had about a 4-sheet flyer that they would start on question one, and they went down through about 200 questions and things that they would go through all of the folks that felt like they needed prayer or help or deliverance. Well, drugs, alcohol, you know, pornography or whatever it was, I can't imagine. But when it got bitterness, anger, envy, strife, you know, all that kind of stuff, start checking things off. Pride. And once we got to the last question, she said, "Now we're going to pray." And she started addressing every one of those. She said, "We're going to ask the Lord to forgive us, and then we're going to begin to praise Him." So we went down through every one of those. "Father, I ask you to forgive me. I've had a wrong heart. I've been angry at my parents. I've been angry with Becky. Father, I've been a bad husband." You know, whatever I could think of, I started, you know, God was breaking me. But she said, "Now we're just going to praise Him and thank Him." And all I did, she didn't grab my chin and go, she said, "Just start worshiping the Lord and thank Him." And the moment I began to thank the Lord and worship Him, I stepped over. She said, "That's it." She said, "That's the life you've got to live. You've got to live there all the time." She's just having it. "Oh, that's it. Worship Him." So October the 29th, 1985 was the last concert I ever did. Because from that point on, I became a worshiper. And that lifestyle became a way of life for our family. The pastor was correct, because the moment the Southern Baptist heard that we had been filled with the Spirit, with evidence of speaking in other tongues, and we lifted our hands and began to lead people into the presence of the Lord, they didn't want anything to do with us, which was 90% of what we did. So our ministry, as we know it and as we knew it, it died. It was over. But one by one, our family stepped into the fullness of the Spirit and the Holy Ghost. It's the only way to live. It's the only way to live. I can give you example after example. I'm going to give you one more, and then we'll just pray. I was going to read from Luke chapter 2, the account of there whenever Christ was born. And the Bible says, "And suddenly there was with the heavenly host, with the angel of heavenly hosts, singing, praising God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." Pastor mentioned this morning about Jehoshaphat, about Joshua. We can give you example after example after example. But here's the thing. God wants to use you to bring suddenlies as well. You see, I know where I'm comfortable. I'm comfortable with the saints of God. I love just being with the family of God. But for me, there are times whenever even the Lord will put me in a position to where I am out of my comfort zone. And He does that on purpose. Because I can depend upon my gift. Okay? In the natural realm, I can depend upon my gift. I can lean on my wife because she can cover me with her gift. But then there are times when the Lord says, I'm up to something here, and I'm going to take you out of your comfort zone. But I'm going to show you that I can have a suddenly, anywhere, anytime I want one. And so your pastors were just in Zambia with Pastor Phil Smithers, one of your friends here, ministry friends. And he asked us to come and spend a week with him. And the way he blesses you at the end of the week is he takes you to the Royal Livingston Hotel so that we can have high tea. And so for me, I'm not much of a high tea guy. They love tea. I'm a coffee guy, okay? So give me a mug. I'm getting my finger in. I'm all good. But you give me one of those little cups, I don't even know how to hold it. Move the thing around, I'll grab the whole thing with my hand because I can't get my finger in the little cup. I don't want to embarrass anybody or offend anybody, but, you know, give me a cup I can get my finger in. So we're there, and the place is filled with, there were close to 400 people there. It's what he tells me. He says close to 400 people on the grounds. They're out there bowling, and they're playing all kinds of games, and there are animals from Africa out there, and the Zambezi River's flowing by, and you see the mist of the Victoria Falls just to your left. You see it just falling off into the abyss. It's just amazing. It's just one of the most incredible places. Inside the place, it's got the thatched roof, and there's a bar behind where we're sitting, about a 40-foot-long bar, and there are Germans, South Africans, sitting at that bar. It's about 3 in the afternoon, so they've been there a while. They're very loud, and they're cheering on their favorite cricket or, you know, rugby game, whatever it is. It's very loud. There's a black gentleman over here playing classical music on a 9-foot Steinway grand piano. It's amazing. The atmosphere is just phenomenal. The guys, you know, are standing there, and they got their hats, you know, the ones that take you to your room with their David Livingston hats, you know, and their bloomer breeches, you know, and the boots. And I mean, it's just amazing. The ladies are in their white linen hats and their white linen, and it's just, oh, you know, the who's who is there. Very, very posh place. And so we're sitting there around this table. There are about 13 or 14 of us. And I'm just enjoying myself, just relaxed, talking. And the maitre d' walks up. And he walks up to me and he goes, "Sir, would you grace us with a song?" And I look up at him like, "I don't know you. What do you mean, grace us with a song?" He said, "No, I understand you're from America. Would you grace us with a song?" Well, my wife goes, "Sure." And so she just puts me on the spot. And I'm going, what in the world am I going to sing? Because if I'm in church, man, I got that covered. Even if it's the song of the Lord, I'm good. But now they want us to sing a song. He's already played parts of Moon River and Somewhere Over the Rainbow. And I don't know. I know the first line of all of those, but that's about it. So Becky goes over and sits down at the piano. And when she sits down at the piano, I looked at her and I said, "What are we going to sing? What are we going to do?" She said, "Follow me." I've been following her a long time. But she said, "Follow me." And so she began to play. Our Father. Which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power
finished the song. All of the outside had cleared and everyone was inside the room. Everyone from the front desk, all the cooks, all the servers, everybody was in the room. And the guys behind me at the bar were frozen. They're frozen. Could not move. They dare not lift their mug. Move. And they all began to clap, and they all stood in reverence to the song. And then the maitre d' made one mistake. He said, "Would you sing one more?" And then when he asked me to sing that second one, then I was at peace. So I asked my wife, I said, "Let's do this. In this room, your presence can be found. As the idols of our soul come crashing down, hearts are opened by your holy wind. As the praises of God's people ascend, so we kneel in honor of you, Lord, as we see you high and lifted up, as your train fills the temple and the cloud moves in, and the glory of the Lord is revealed. The cloud of your glory fills this place. The glow of your presence is on each face. We enter in by the sacrifice of praise.
with clean hands and a heart that's pure, we say, Lord, your presence is all that we embrace. The cloud of your glory fills this place. The cloud of your glory, the Holy of Holies, the cloud of your glory fills this place. The cloud of your glory, the Holy of Holies, the cloud of your glory fills this place. This place. Hallelujah. 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 Let me share just a couple of things. Growing up in church, I was able to see many, many wonderful things. I remember as a young man in those revival meetings with my dad, I remember the day, this was pre-baptism in the Holy Ghost with Evan speaking other tongues, but I remember in those meetings helping lead the worship and doing the invitation when my dad would stand down front. And I remember one instance where a young mom come walking down the aisle and the baby was like 5-6 days old and she's weeping. And she basically handed my dad her baby and I watched her. She said, my baby's dying. And my dad turned to the pastor of this First Baptist church and he said, I need some oil. And the pastor said, we don't have any oil. He said, I need some oil. And one of the men left and came back and all they could find was 3-in-1 oil, sewing machine oil, or typewriter oil. That's all they could find. He said, this is all we got. That's the understanding that they had. And my dad took that little can. He went, ticky, ticky, and put some in his hands. And he laid his hands on that 5-day-old baby. I remember this. Talking about suddenness. And I watched my dad lay hands on that baby, and I heard him say, Father, you are a healer. We need a miracle. He laid hands on that baby, and he looked at the mom, and he said, you just thank the Lord that it's done. That's all I heard him say. The pastor was freaking out. I remember we finished that week, and he's like, I still can't believe you told that girl just to put your faith out there that God's going to. We went home. 3 weeks later, Dad gets a phone call from that pastor. Brother Joe, this is Pastor so-and-so down here in so-and-so, Texas. He said, you know that baby you prayed for 3 weeks ago? Dad said, yes. He said, the blood's turned, that baby's perfectly whole. That baby's perfectly whole. We're down in Big Lake, Texas. I might have told some of these stories last time I was here. We're in the middle of doing a revival meeting, and the wind is blowing. Been in West Texas, you can have a sandstorm. They don't just stop. It takes a while. But in the midst of that sandstorm, as long as we were singing with a sound system, we could sing above it. But when Dad got ready to preach, I'm probably 17 years old. My brother John's 13 or 14. Can't remember. He's real young. And we're sitting there, and Dad steps up to the mic, and he says, folks, about 800 people there. Dad says, folks, he said, I tell you what, he said, we need a miracle here tonight. He said, if we're going to continue on, he said, we just need to ask God to stop the wind. I looked at my brother, and I went, no, he's not. He said, so let's just pray. And he said, if God doesn't stop the wind, we'll just say in Jesus' name, amen, and we'll go home. But my dad began to pray, and I'm looking at my brother, and I said, he's fixing to embarrass us. But as my dad said, Father, we thank you. This is your meeting. If you want us to continue on, you're going to have to stop the wind. And Father, we simply thank you that it's done in Jesus' name, amen. When he said amen, it was like you closed a book, and it went, shoo.
deathly. You can hear a pin drop. And all the people are looking around like. And I'm looking at my brother going. And then my dad said, I want every head bowed and every eye closed. Went straight in the invitation. When we started the work in Austin, Texas, we'd been there about a month. Had the sign outside, Pastors Joe and Becky Cruse. This elderly couple came and sat toward the back of the building. So after the service was over, I walked back to where they were and I said, hi, I'm Joe Cruse, my wife Becky. How are y'all doing? They said, we're doing fantastic. He said, son, are you that Joe Cruse? You part of that Cruse family that was at Big Lake, Texas when God stopped the wind? I said, yes, sir, I'm the son. I'm the oldest son. He said, boy, he said, I want to tell you something. I'm 50-some-odd years old. He said, boy, let me tell you something. He said, every Friday we have coffee at the Dairy Queen. He said, son, did you know they still talk to this day about the day God stopped the wind in Big Lake, Texas? The suddenlies of God. The suddenlies of God. When God begins to move and he puts his hand on you, you know it. Everything changes. Everything changes. Let me share two things and I'll just begin to pray. The suddenlies, listen, I know why your pastor is so passionate about you stepping into the realms of the Holy Spirit. Not just a service, not just a touch, but living in the realms of glory. That you begin to expect these suddenlies, because these suddenlies launch you into your purpose. Me seeing these suddenlies, they launched me to another level. God began to give us the songs on the God is Great CD long before Pastor Rodney Howard Brown ever came to our church. But he's teaching on a Tuesday morning. I didn't even really know him. 3,500 people are in the building. And when I was sitting there and he walked in front of me, he just stopped for a minute. He looked at me. And like an idiot, I go, I've got a song. And being gracious or whatever, he said, come sing it. And it was The Cloud of Your Glory, the one I just did. I'd never fallen out under the power of the Holy Ghost. Never. Ever. But that night, that Tuesday night in that meeting, he had his full team there. He didn't need me. He went to his one and he said, come and sing this song. And when he reached to hand the mic, you've probably seen this, he went to hand the mic to him for them to sing. They fell out on the floor. And then he went to the next one, Brother John Holcomb. Hand the mic, grinning, hand the mic to him. Molly Kelly, come sing. Grinning, he hands the microphone. Then he does this. He goes, Joe, come here. I went, oh, my God. I'm not falling. I'm not falling. I'm not falling. Had to walk up 13 steps to get to him. He's grinning at me the whole time. I'm not falling. All I know is this. I got to this top step. And when he reached out to hand me the microphone, 2.5 hours later, I woke up looking at the roof. The suddenlies of God. They launch you to another realm. They launch you to another realm. He's no respecter of persons. You don't have to be a pastor's son or a daughter. You don't have to grow up in church. But these suddenlies, they launch you to another realm. These nights are an opportunity for you to go to another level. Your pastor, he's passionate about it. But he wants you to know those realms that he walks in. He wants you to come up to another level, to another place. You see, we cannot get hungry for you. You have to get hungry for yourself. The fire of God is there to equip you. Romas de lemon rindeste, to equip you. When that coal of fire touches your lips, it's all over. When the burning bush comes, you'll go back to Pharaoh and you'll say, let my people go. You see, the fire of God, it prepares you for what God's called you to do. And not only that, it purges you and purifies you from the things that will hold you back. The fire protects you from anything the enemy throws your way. And it empowers you. The Word of God comes alive on the inside of you to do the works of Jesus. And then last of all, it prolongs you with long life. You'll see the satisfaction of God established in your life. I wouldn't live any other way. That's why for myself, I'm looking for the suddenlies, because they can happen anywhere, anytime. One last testimony. The offering's been taken, so you understand the motive of my heart. Last August, we were preparing to go to Asia in October. And the tickets alone were going to cost us over $13,000 just for the tickets. That's coach, by the way. And we were headed to about three different places that were very small. I know the pastors. I love them very much. And I knew what the offerings normally were. And we get to this one place in Florida on Sunday morning, and we're on our way to church, and I hear the phone ring. And so I look down, or buzz, and I look down at it, and I get a text message from a friend. They live back in Austin, and they've sown seed. They used to be a part of our church, and they're now in other places and doing different things. And they made a statement like, well, have you seen, or have you, he said, have you gotten the offering we sent you? And it was said in a way that was like, you haven't said thank you. I haven't even seen it yet. Come to find out, they sent it through my Chase bank, and it was direct deposited, so I didn't see it. I guess Chase was doing work over the weekend. I hadn't seen it. So I texted him, I'm so sorry I haven't seen it, da-da-da-da-da. Please forgive me, but thank you ahead of time. We went ahead, did the meetings that day. It was a blessing. That offering was $2,000. We go on through the week. We go to this next place. Becky's going to do a ladies' conference, and they spontaneously took her an offering just for her. And they said, we want to bless you. So I told my wife, I said, we're not using that for this trip. That is your money. Because they specifically said they wanted to bless you with that offering. So then we get ready for Sunday. We minister on Sunday morning. Heaven falls. We're having a great time. A man walks up to me at the end of the meeting, and he said, I was a part of the river when y'all were there with Rodney when you started the church. And he said, I'd gone through a failed marriage and a failed business. And he said, I had nothing. But he said, God has redeemed all of that. And he said, my business has exploded. And he said, I want to sow a seed into you and tell your ministry and say thank you. And it was a check for $1,000. We go to the Sunday night service. And we're ministering, and we get through. And a couple walks up to us at the end of the meeting. And they're just weeping. They said, Brother Joe, you'll never know what you and Pastor Becky have meant to us in the ministry. And they said, we had already set aside $10,000 for our taxes this year. And they said, we have money set aside, so I've got money for my taxes. But he said, we'd kind of earmarked this money ahead of time for our taxes. But he said, in the middle of the meeting, the Lord said, that money needs to go toward the cruises. I hadn't said anything about our trip, didn't push anything about all that. Check for $10,000. There was the 13 without touching any of the offerings to help take care of the rest of the needs of the ministry. And I looked at my wife and I said, when God tells us it's going to be a year of suddenlies, we better listen. Because he's trying to teach us something and tell us something. So for somebody here tonight, you're believing God for a suddenly. For someone here tonight, you've been asking the Lord for that baptism of the Holy Spirit with evidence speaking other tongues. And it's been hard. It shouldn't be hard. It's as natural as taking a glass of water and taking a drink. That's how simple it is. It's as easy as lifting that glass, because naturally, let me tell you, naturally you swallow. You'll swallow. Yeah, you'll swallow. You put something up there and it starts to go down the wrong place, you're going to swallow. Oh, yeah, you will. And it's amazing how when you, with a hungry heart, say, Lord, I hunger and I thirst for more of you. It's amazing how he comes with that glass of water. I'm telling you, it's like he's standing there waiting. You're thirsty? I have what you need to drink. Some of you here tonight, you need joy. Joy is just a praise away. It is. Remasta, it's just a praise away. She didn't have to tell me how to step. I didn't grow up in Pentecost. I was a Baptist boy. Matter of fact, I'd heard all along, that's not right. That's of the devil. You know, that's all passed away. But you see, God had been preparing me with suddenlies along the way, that he could still perform miracles. It had happened to me. So if that could happen to me, why not step into the fullness of the Holy Ghost as well? Let's stand our feet tonight. The presence of the Lord is here. He wants to pour out his spirit afresh upon you. For somebody here tonight, he has a new tongue for you. He has a new tongue for you. Oh yeah, he has a brand new tongue for you. Remanalo istebende, rinestepa, kolema. All you have to do is step over, begin to stir the gift of God on the inside of you, and you will step into a new realm. Around a new realm of faith. Ramano stikele, rebenda leninia sta. But if the fire of God is upon you, the touch of heaven is on you tonight, just step out from where you're seated and come to the front of this auditorium, and let's just lift up our hands. We'll lay hands upon you and pray for you for a fresh touch of heaven. But we cannot get hungry for you. You have to get hungry for yourself. Hungry for yourself. Menanola stide. Menanola de aste kaba. Roba la la mandele most helidie. Ramama mama lode de sara. Ramama, you see, praise has a voice. You cannot be ashamed of your voice. To receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, don't be ashamed of what it sounds like. Thank the Lord for that. Step over. Step over. Malolabasti kelamarolenende. Just step over. Step over. He's the baptizer in the Holy Ghost. Just begin to speak the name of Jesus. He's the baptizer in the Holy Ghost. Let's lift your hands. Lift your hands. Lift your hands. The Bible speaks of a river. A river. Thus spake he of the Holy Ghost. It's not a one-time experience. It's a river. It flows every day. Another thing about a river, you cannot contain it. You may be able to dam it up, but it'll find a way out, because it's flowing. It's flowing. The river of God flows. The presence of God, he flows. It's a flow. It's a flow. Walking with God is a flow. It's 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 a flow. Mambrosta kerena ma rebende. La ma shelebende ma robande. Hola mama ma shelebende niasa. Robala mama mama le bondolo musica. It's a flow. It's a flow. It's a flow. Thank you, Father. It's a flow. It's a flow. We're not too young. It's a flow. My grandbabies, they pray in the Holy Ghost. Lord, fill the babies. Fill the babies with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Lord, fill the babies. Fill the babies with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Come on, you can live like this. When you wake up in the morning, full of the Holy Ghost, praying in other tongues. Walking in the power, the Holy Ghost. Ramanana melede, lobola bastelanende, from the top of our head to the soles of our feet. Lemanana la mandele levalo, selamana delede, sola mama la lelabola, selaminanende, full of the Holy Ghost, full of the Holy Ghost. Kula mandele day, full of the Holy Ghost, full of the Holy Ghost. Lord, bless the moms. Lord, bless these new moms. Give them strength. Fire. Fire, the Holy Ghost. Fire. More fire. Fire, the Holy Ghost. Fire, the Holy Ghost. Come on, stir it up. 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 Hallelujah. Fresh fire. Fresh fire. Fresh fire. Fresh fire.